German?
Me?
German, yeah. Guten Tag. Good morning, really. I have a co-worker in Norway. Apparently they say hello. In Spain, it's going to be buenos dias. Is that right? We also have a co-founder from New Zealand. He's not Maori, but if he were, he would say kia ora. In Quebecois French, bonjour. I just threw this one in there. Good eye, mate. And hello says Queen. And hello in, that was too fast. Hello in, I have to just slower. That was bad animation. I apologize. It would say Red Bull English. We're here in beautiful city of Buffalo. The last time I was here in Buffalo, New York, I was writing code that looks like this at a conference called YAPSI so many years ago. Buffalo is probably the only word in English that you can form a coherent sentence by repeating itself more than five times.
Little difficult to see on top, but
was running tests on run code run, and it was working great, except that run code run could not make money, and they had to shut down in March 21st, 2010. Sven was sad. And what did he say? Well, it must be easy to replicate the service that Run Code Run was doing. This is June 16, 2010, about two months after the demise of Run Code Run. He put this out. He says, so I figured it should be easy to set up a few apps on Heroku and leave them run the i18n test suite on different stacks, and it turns out it is not. Familiar story. Soon Sven was joined by Josh, Constantine, and Matthias, and Travis CI GmbH was formed. They raised their own money to start the company. And here it is. They have the money, the revenue generating service. And everyone was happy. Happy and lived happily ever after, right? Yes.
Or did they?
Or did they? And then they got successful. Then things got a little bad. Okay, I'm going to explain what this graph is. On the x-axis, you see the date, 9th of February through 15th. It's about a week's worth of data. On the y-axis, you see the number. That is the number of jobs running on Travis CI. Okay, you see the blue on the bottom and the red on the top. The blue ones are running jobs. And when there are reds, that means there are jobs waiting to run. We have a fixed capacity at about 480. So above 480, you can't run and you have to wait. Okay. So this is a victim of its own success, and people were sad, especially this baby. Look at it, it's a very, very sad graph. So why is that? When you have a fixed capacity, it is like an airplane, paper airplane. You can make it really, really complicated and looking great, but once you throw it, there is no way for you to control. When the Wright brothers really had the first flight, manned flight in 1903, they didn't just get the patent for flying. Right? Flying is easy. If you can just fly, go as fast as you can, you know, if you don't care about where you land, how you land, and so on, you can just fly. The patent that the Wright brothers had is to control the pitch, yaw, and roll of the aircraft so that you can land and you can do it again over and over. Right? So that's precisely where the theory would come in. When you have a system, it will get you the output based on whatever input you have. The system here means almost anything. Your body, your air conditioning system, your car, and so on. What you can do to influence what happens to the system is to put some sort of input control in front of the system, and how you change the input based on this output from the system. Okay, this many ways to do it. Believe it or not, it can be random. Some people are influenced by random events. And it can be mechanical. Can you see what it is? Okay, so this is a mechanical thermostat. Let's see, so there is a coil on the right side, and this is the same thing from the other side. This device will sit between two chambers of different temperatures, and the coil will be exposed to the hot liquid, and when the liquid heats up the coil will expand, and this part will pop out into the cool liquid. Cool liquid will go into the hot chamber, and it will cool down the hot liquid, and the liquid will contract the coil so that it shuts off the flow between the two chambers, so that the thermostat will control the temperature on the hot chamber. Right? This is what you have in your car, or used to anyway. I don't know how the thermostats work in these days in modern cars. You can also have a mechanical thermostat like that. Or you can have a very sophisticated control system like 747. I don't know what these controls are. I can't find them. All these things were formalized by these two physicists, mathematicians, Simon, I forgot the names, Laplace, and Jean-Baptiste Joseph Fourier. And their theory will go a little beyond the scope of this talk. So I'm going to introduce a very common controller, which is called PID controller. It is not process ID. The controller will look at the difference between the actual signal and the desired signal level. On the x-axis, you see time t, and on the y-axis, you see the signal level. Signal level really doesn't matter what it is, as long as you can measure it. So we are going to look at the E of t, the difference between the desired output level and the actual output level. How far away are we from the desired level? For example, if you have a thermostat set to 72 degrees Fahrenheit, and if it is the air temperature is 74 degrees, you know that you are 2 degrees away, so you have to cool it down. If your air temperature is 68 degrees, you're 4 degrees away, you have to heat it up. Right? So that's the sort of thing. And you have E of t over time like that. And I am going to normalize it to the zero level. And you think, well, how are we going to influence the system based on this information error? Well, at time t, you have some difference E of t. If we are far away from the target value, you have to make big change. Right? If you are 10 degrees away from the desired signal, desired temperature, you have to cool it down faster or heat it up faster. Right? Or over time, you have accumulated a lot more debt, so to speak. A lot more error, then you have to work a little harder, right? Because there is a big difference historically. Or you can look at how fast the error is changing. Right? If the error explode. If the error is not changing fast, then you might want to work a little harder. So you can look at three of these historical past information, present information, and recent past. You can look at the coefficients in front. This is the present value, this is the integral value, and this is the derivative. Again, we have proportional component, integral component, and derivative. And here we have PID controller, right? If you hold two of those coefficients constant, you can look at how each of those coefficients will affect the system performance. Here we are looking at the proportional constant. Let's see, you can see that the for k equals 0.5, the system will go very slowly, and eventually it gets to the point very close to the target signal around t equals 8. If it's bigger, at k equals 1.1, it is going to shoot up really fast and overshoots the target, and then error correction makes the error signal dip, and then it's going to go back to desired level around 3.5. If the constant is too big, the system will behave a little erratically and going back and forth, and it goes to the desired level about 9.5. Same happens with other coefficients here, and you can see how the coefficients can affect the system controller's performance. Wrapping up, you can see that the faster convergence is very good, right? If you have a thermostat that doesn't do a lot of work, that is a better one. If it doesn't exhibit this kind of behavior for k equals 1.6, it's a good one, right? You don't want to be hot, cold, hot, cold, hot, cold, eventually get comfortable. That's not very nice. So you want to talk about how these controllers work. Oh, I had these again, sorry. So you can say that some systems are slow to react to changes, you know, in addition to the things that we talked about with the coefficients. Why is that? How does that work? Some systems are not going to change based on the input all the way, right? Here we have a, can you see the pots on the stove? Okay, so the input here will be the fire in the stove. You can put more wood in there, and you can take the wood off. You don't take the wood off. You can is going to heat up the pot, and then pot is going to heat up whatever is in the pot. It will take time for the thing that you're really interested in, the food in the pot, to heat up. From the time that you put in the wood in the stove to actually you eat it. Right? There is a time difference between the time you put in the wood and the time your food is ready for consumption. You can also talk about delay. When you open the faucet, it will take time for the water to travel the entire hose and the water to come out of the hose. Right? There are slightly different kind of time. sponsored me for Travis. Remember this graph, this sad graph. We want to add more capacity to the blue part so that we have less of red. We use EC2. There's this thing called a load scaling group. They will put together EC2 instances together so that they can serve a single purpose. In order to change the capacity, they use this thing called dynamic scaling policies. It will let you choose how you are going to add or subtract the capacity from the older scaling group. They can use metrics, it can be controlled by schedule, or it can be controlled by simple queuing service. I don't think you can combine the more than one kind to change the scaling, which is a problem. You can adjust by changing capacity, how many you want to add or how many you want to subtract. Or you can set it to the exact capacity. If this thing happens, I want 5 instances in this auto scaling group, for example. Or you can change how much based on the present capacity. If you have 100 instances in the auto scaling group and you want to change by 10% or 10% up or 10% down, it doesn't matter how many you have in the group, but it is going to be done by percentage. Notice that none of these things will fit nicely with the PID controller that we talked about. So we have to improvise a little bit. Current policy is that we're going to use metrics and changing capacity, meaning that we measure something, and if we have too many instances to serve the current load, we're going to reduce by 1, I think. And if we don't have enough of them, there's more demand than we can handle, we're going to bump it up by, I think, 4. Doesn't matter the exact number, but there's a problem because, well, we have lag and delay. You can see delays here. We have lags here. So let's look at how the system is going to behave. We have the threshold shown in the red and the capacity in the blue on top. At the bottom, we have the headroom, which I define as the difference between the capacity and the current load. Here, you see that we have exceeded the headroom. The headroom has exceeded the threshold, so we're going to reduce the number of instances in the auto-scaling group, and it is going to reduce until we go the headroom goes under the threshold. There is a delay in the system capacity, and we start adding capacity a little later. Right? You can see that. Yeah. And we're going to add more capacity because there is not enough of that in the headroom. And then we dip over the threshold for only a little bit, tiny bit. And then we're going to start reducing. But then there is a big surge in demand, which we cannot meet because there is a delay in system response, and we have a big dip where we cannot meet the demand for a long time. So if we have the headroom set to about 40, the graph would look like that. your stat graph. It's a little better than the one that we had before, right? But it's still a stat graph. So how do you improve this? We can have bigger headroom. Do you like this? Do you like, thank you. And if you have bigger headroom for the auto scaling group, you have a lot less red. Yay! Right? But it costs a lot of money. And over this one is for 24 hours. You can see that we still have a red, but it's a lot better than the one we have. And we still have red. And this is for 3 days. Another way is to get shorter delays. The reason that we have a long delay is a little bit of a implementation details, and I'm not going to go into that, but that will certainly help, right? Shorter delay in the system will let your system be more responsive to the change in the demand. And there are also other things that I probably haven't thought about. But I think I'm running out of time. And here we have a 24-hour period that is just last yesterday. No, the day before. The day before. And we can still see that the we have red, but not as bad as we used to be. We have to balance the two different goals. We have a huge demand, or we want to save money. Right? We want to make sure that we are providing the best service while making sure that we can stay in business. This one is for 3 days. You can see that the graph is a little less granular. But I have learned a few things about control theory while looking at this graph. And I would welcome your questions at this time. Yeah. So the question is, can you predict the surge in demand based on time or other things? Yes. In general, when the United States wakes up, the demand goes up. And in some ways, we could respond to that based on the scheduling policy that I mentioned for EC2 auto scaling group. The problem is that I do not think that you can combine the schedules and metrics. Yes, we can, and we probably could, and that's something that we can look into. Why don't you spend more money? And we used to. EC2 is not cheap. It is.
You don't have extra cash.
Right. So maybe we don't have enough money. Maybe we do, but the. Why don't we?
Well, we had to take VC at that point.
That's the key word. We don't have VC funding, so we are not throwing money at the problem as freely as we might otherwise. How about speeding up the bills? That is yes and no. Even if the bills are 100 times faster, the demand, the problem will persist, right? The capacity will not change, and demand will not change, even if the each bill is shorter. Okay? It doesn't matter how long each bill is, but the demand stays the same. I mean, you're not convinced of that. I can talk to you about that later. is 60 seconds, I believe. And even if we had a shorter period of time, the culprit right now is the delay and the lag. In order to respond better, you need to shorten those things. The question is, can you let call less frequently and respond better? And I don't think that the answer, I don't think it's going to be that easy. I should say, as I said, the real culprit is the long lag. No, delay, sorry, delay. It takes a long time for the capacity to come online. That is the real issue here. And we have tried to make that happen. And there are technical reasons why we have not been able to do that. I think the gentleman, as you had the right idea, if we can predict how the capacity is going to be at a certain time, you can pre-boot and meet those demands that we can fairly anticipate. And that's something that we can look into. Ah, yes. So the question is, can we do better with the easy to boot up time, right? Okay. So, yes and no. That is the somewhat implementation detail that I didn't go over. But right now, we have to pull in a lot of Docker images from the internet to make the instance ready. You can optimize in many different ways. You can have smaller Docker images, for example, or you can pull fewer Docker images to make sure that you can meet the demands correctly. But there are problems to those approaches, and we have not had the capacity to address those issues. There are other pressing operations needs to investigate those things at this time. The question is, have you thought about putting a Docker registry closer to the EC2 groups so that the pull